here with HDYO's Breaking Down Barriers series for another casual conversation between myself and Ashley Clark, and usually a member of the HD community research community. The Breaking Down Barriers series is an important initiative so we can help bring up conversations that are more accessible to the community to bridge that gap in terms of communicating the exciting things happening in the HD field. So without further ado, I'm Lauren Byrne. I'm a principal research fellow at UCL, University College London, and I'm also a HD family member, and I'm here with Ashley, who will introduce herself.
Hi everybody, my name is Ashley. I am in Northern Ireland and I have been a patient advocate for just over about 15 years. I'm involved in a couple of different charities and organisations and a member of the HDYO board.
And we are delighted to have Anne-Marie back with us from Wave Life Sciences. If some of you may have seen our session with Anne-Marie, I think about a year ago, giving us an update on their program Select HD, which you'll hear a bit more about. But Anne-Marie, could you reintroduce yourself for the audience?
Thank you, Lauren. So I'm Anne-Marie Lee Kwai Chung. I'm the Chief Development Officer for Wave Life Sciences, and I've worked for 25 years in basically neuroscience development. A significant portion of that spent in research for Huntington's disease. It's a course very close to my heart, and I'm excited to talk to you today about our more recent data.
So the reason we're having a follow-up is because we had some exciting positive news for a change in the HD space back in June. So maybe before we get into what that news is, Anne-Marie, could you give us a reminder about what Select HD is and what the program entails?
Absolutely. So Select HD was a first in humans, that's phase 1b/2a clinical study to evaluate WAVE 003, which is our investigational therapy for HD. And it included adults with early manifest HD. Manifest means people with HD who already have symptoms of the disease. And it was people who carried a single nucleotide polymorphism, SNP3, which is relevant to the mechanism for which WAVE 003 works, so allele-selective.
So tell us a bit more maybe about that, because I think we all need a reminder of that.
Yeah, so everybody inherits one gene from each of their biological parents, including the Huntington gene. And people who don't have Huntington's disease have two healthy copies of the Huntington gene. But people who have HD inherit normally one copy where there's a mutation, which means that a protein that should be healthy is abnormal. And this is the Huntington protein. And the Huntington protein, the abnormal protein, aggregates in the brain. And also people with Huntington's disease have less of the healthy protein, which is important for normal brain function. So for allele selectivity, what we're looking for, this single nucleotide polymorphism, it's like a pin in the map. And basically it allows us to identify the RNA that has come from the mutant gene and selectively reduce the abnormal protein and hopefully spare the healthy protein. How's that?
Brilliant. What do you think, Ashley?
I was just going to say, even I got that. I was like, so you're going after the mutant Huntington protein. I'm like, got that.
And it's probably helpful to think, we say allele is just a fancy word of saying a copy of a gene.
That's right.
So if you hear that, that's all we're saying. Allele selective is just selecting the copy that contains the instructions for the mutated protein or the bad guy. Brilliant. So what kind of drug is that? how does it work? I guess it's not just a pill you can take, or
no, it's administered via lumbar puncture. It's an antisense oligonucleotide. It's basically a strand of RNA. It binds to the complementary strand, and through there's an enzyme in the body, basically breaks down the complementary strand of RNA, so the abnormal protein, the mutant protein, then isn't created. So it should reduce the amount of abnormal protein that's being aggregated, basically just clumping together and forming, and hopefully then also spare the healthy protein that is being created from the other genes.
So just to remind listeners, DNA is the kind of material that our genes are made of, and the code that writes our DNA or our genes, and they're basically the blueprint or the instructions to make that protein, the Huntingtin protein. But in that step in the cells, it's a bit more complicated, where we have a messenger in between, because we want to keep the instructions really healthy and not damage them. So they get to stay in this safe compartment called the nucleus of the cell, and then those get made into a copy, which is made out of RNA, which similar to the drug that Anne-Marie just mentioned, and it's that copy that this drug is binding to, and the complement binding and targeting, and by binding to it, it triggers the cell to kind of get rid of it. And then if you have less of the message, then the cells can't actually make the protein, and therefore we have Huntingtin lowering.
Yeah, it's very complicated, but thank you so much for explaining it like that. I think that's much clearer. So the study was a randomized placebo-controlled study, so that doctors and participants didn't know whether they were receiving 003 or the placebo. And it was designed to measure safety and tolerability of 003, but also how it behaves in the body, or about pharmacokinetics, so you know, how it's absorbed and then metabolized and eliminated in the body. And there were also exploratory objectives, which included looking at the reduction of the abnormal mutant protein and whether or not it was also sparing the healthy Huntingtin protein. It wasn't powered, so that means it wasn't designed to look at the clinical effects of the disease. So a clinical effect, these are things, basically ways in which we measure how someone with HD feels, functions, or survives. And in clinical studies, you have to define specific questions that the study wants to answer. And you would define those as primary, so like the main outcomes, secondary, which could be other interesting outcomes, and exploratory endpoints. These are things that, you know, we're interested to look at, but we don't know yet enough about the drug to design a study to explicitly look at those outcomes. And that will help doctors and patients and regulators who would approve drugs in the future determine really whether something is working as it's intended and whether it can ever have any benefit for humans in the future. So SELECT-HD wasn't designed to look at the clinical outcomes, so basically, you know, how it's impacting the disease, because it wasn't large enough or long enough to do that. But we did obviously look at those outcomes, and we have got some interesting things to share with you. Those things can't be overinterpreted, but they are, I think, interesting just to think about at this early stage.
Go ahead, Ashley.
Sorry. So this trial, it was, you know, safety was at like the top of your list of what you were looking at, but you did look at these other fields.
That's right.
Background, and it's like, does that then help you identify then, like, okay, so yes, it was safe and tolerable, and then you've loosely looked at, you know, the clinical side of things, and then that'll help you then gauge maybe for like the next part of the trial or where you've moved forward, like, so is that why you would have like point A is my safety, point B, C, and D are these, and it's just to touch on them to then maybe focus on that the next time? Would that be right?
I think that's a really good way to explain it. So the primary outcome was safety and tolerability. So the side effects that we saw and how patients experienced receiving the drug. Secondary endpoints included looking at how it was really impacting the abnormal protein and sparing the healthy protein. And then exploratory endpoints looked at the disease. And you're exactly right. These early indicators and the disease help us design the future studies. And that's why we collect them, even though we know that the study is not really designed to answer that question.
And that just really highlights, you know, the what the phases of drug development mean. So when we say a phase 1B, 2A, it's because a phase 1 is always about safety and tolerability. And that little, you know, 2A part is the fact that you're getting a little extra information that you might get from a phase 2 trial, which is trying to give you understand, the find the right dose and see if you're hitting the target and how much you need to kind of change that to make sure you're hitting it enough to see an effect, and also not too much that you're going to cause any damage, or because every, you know, there's always every drug, if you give too much of it, it's going to be not good. So what would you say, tell us more about the kind of top line results and what do you think is the headline?
Sure. So in the study, we had a single ascending dose portion, so looking at doses going, you know, up. But then in the multi-dose portion, we looked at 30 milligrams dosed every 8 weeks, a total of 3 doses. So these are the results.
Give a bit more clarity, so like a single ascending dose is just a group of patients get one dose and then you see how that goes. The next group get a higher dose and you see how that goes, and then when it gets to the multiple ascending
one and
doses,
done, is it single doses like one and done?
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah. And it's very normal when you're testing a new drug just to be really safe, because this is the first time these drugs are going into human beings. We don't know how they're going to affect, so it's very normal and good practice to do that. But obviously the type of drug, it probably will need more doses, so that's where the multiple dosing bit comes in. Sorry to drop down.
No, that's a great explanation. Thank you so much, Lauren. And in the multi-dose, you know, HD is a lifelong disease, and so eventually for it to be a drug, the drug has to be dosed, you know, long term. So this is an early look at sort of multi-dose data, but it's of course only 3 doses, so more dosing and more exploration of continuing to dose wave 003 will be needed.
So what did you say the dosing was? It was
30 milligrams every 8 weeks, every 2 months, 30 milligrams injected through lumbar puncture.
And what did you say? Did you say something about 3 times?
The patients in this part of the study received 3 doses. Yeah. No, great questions.
It just wasn't like, it wasn't calling in.
There's lots of numbers. So safety and tolerability were the first endpoints, so maybe good to cover those first. So generally, 003 was safe and well tolerated. The adverse events in this portion of the study were mild to moderate. So adverse events can be rated as mild, moderate, or severe. And obviously, ideally, you want adverse events to be at the lower end of that, which means then they're not as bad. And there were no serious adverse events, which is also good.
And serious, just to give people kind of a reference for what that might mean, serious or severe, would mean usually hospitalization. Is that a
serious serious adverse events are events that hospitalize patients and or are life-threatening? And pregnancy is also considered to be a serious adverse event, because when we do these clinical studies, we don't know enough about the drug for people to be conceiving children at the same time. So all of those things are considered serious, and none of those things occurred in this study.
I'm just wondering, like, because we're talking about like adverse events, is that what the word is?
Yes.
Like what are we talking about here? Like it's one thing, I'm just thinking of like coming from the community and with so much, you know, updates and stuff coming, what are we talking about when we say an adverse event? Like, are we talking, because I think people have this like perception whenever they hear about drug trials and they imagine like what we see in the films where somebody has grew an extra toe, you know, I'm like, literally. So I'm just like, can we have, I'm not asking, like, would you have some examples of what are like minor, I can't remember the three. I mean,
Moderate,
how
severe,
moderate
and
and severe.
severe.
So an adverse event is basically any symptom or lab value that is reported for the patient in the study as the study progresses. And on top of that, there's another classification that's called treatment-related. And so that's the adverse events that the investigator thought were actually related to the drug administration. So when you do a clinical study, you collect everything. Everything that the patient reports, you collect it because you need to assess these data and try to understand which one of these might actually be related to the drug and which could just be, incidental. So for instance, I was going to the site or going home from the site, let's say, and I fell off my bike. That would be reported as an adverse event. And we would need to look at our data to try to work out, and the investigator would do this too. Did this patient fall off their bike because of the administration of the drug? Or, did someone just step out in front of them while they were cycling? And so it's really not to do with the drug. So that's a very kind of minor example. But when we look at the adverse events, they really can be anything. It could be headaches. It could be somebody had a cold, somebody vomited, or anything really, anything that happens to the patient in the study. And when we look at these adverse events, we're looking at the number, we're looking at any patterns to see whether we could actually be getting a signal that this is related to the drug administration. And we're looking at the severity. So, I had a little bit of a headache, or I had, kind of a moderate headache. I needed some drug, or I had such a bad headache, I needed to be kept in hospital because I felt so unwell. So, it's quite complex, but we spend a lot of time thinking and looking at these different events and trying to interpret what they mean.
No, that's a really good way to explain it. And I appreciate like the reference of like the bike and stuff, because that's, as you're explaining that, all I could think was it must be really difficult to determine, because this drug trial obviously goes on for like a period of time if you're, if you're given the doses every 8 weeks. So it must be so hard to determine like what is a general health, like I've got a sniffly cold, I all of a sudden suffer from migraines due to a change in my like work environment or something. So it must be hard to figure out what is due to the drug and then what is just like general health in a person. I'd never thought of it that way, so you've definitely made me look at it in a different way that I hadn't before.
That's great. Well, I mean, the placebo helps us because we look at what has been reported in the placebo and what's been reported in the active, and we look at the difference between them. And so that helps us kind of screen out anything which is just incidental. But, you do one study. Basically, when you get to the end of your drug development journey, you've normally exposed quite a large number of patients. And the more patients you expose, the more obvious it becomes what is really related to the drug administration and what isn't. And as Lauren said earlier, that's important because all drugs come with risks and benefits. And so what we're trying to do as we do these clinical studies is really understand, is there benefit for administering the drug? So is it having an impact on the disease or markers of the disease and biomarkers, and what risks are associated with it? And ultimately, for a drug to be approved, we say that the benefit risk balance needs to be positive. So there needs to be more benefits to taking the drug than there are risks to taking the drug. So it's I'm like complete drug development geek. I find this very
I am
interesting.
also, so it's really nice to break it down. I think it's really helpful for people to think about it. We get so used to hearing these terms because there's so many acronyms in drug development. It is insane. But so it's kind of a different language sometimes, and it's really helpful to break it down, I think, for this audience.
Thank you, Lauren. There were a few other safety things that I want to mention, just interest of balance, making sure we're telling you everything that happened. So we looked at something called ventricular volume, which is ventricles are these basically spaces inside the brain, and for some other therapies of this same type, increases in the size of these ventricles have been observed. Now, everybody's ventricles are expanding over time with age, and people with HD also, that's true. But for some other drugs, the ventricles have become expanded more quickly than you would expect if they weren't, the patients were not treated. So this is something that we keep a very close eye on. And in this study, the size of the ventricles and the change of the ventricles of the patients in the study were consistent with what we would see in natural history. So other patients with Huntington's disease who are being followed over time. And there were no cases of something called hydrocephalus. And this is when the pressure in the brain becomes too great. And that is also related to the size of the ventricles, essentially. And then finally, there was something else that we looked at, which is called neurofilament light. And this is a protein, and it's a marker of neuronal injury. And we measured this in the cerebral spinal fluid and also in the plasma. And in this study, we did see some increases in NFL, and that's the acronym that we use, in the cerebral spinal fluid, not in the plasma. We saw these increases. They were largely overlapping with placebo, but for some patients, it did exceed placebo. After stopping treatment with 003, we saw that the NFL plateaued or reduced. And we looked at the correlation between NFL and safety, like the adverse events we were just talking about, the number of adverse events, the severity of adverse events. We didn't see a correlation between these NFL increases and the adverse events.
So just to give a bit more context, NFL.
So... I was just going to, anybody tell by my face that I'm completely lost?
Oh, sorry. So NFL is kind of my thing. This is my day job.
Well, Lauren.
So, it's my favorite protein. But it is a protein that is found in all of our brain cells. So it basically helps brain cells hold their structure, which is very important to how brain cells talk and communicate and do their jobs. And when there's injury, we see that it gets released into the CSF, so the spinal fluid, which is in direct contact with the brain. But it also gets released into blood, but much lower concentrations. In general, we're trying to lower NFL as a potential marker of the drug working to protect the brain and help stop that damage that we know is happening in Huntington's. But also there's been cases where when NFL goes up, it's maybe because a drug or a non-related event like a traumatic brain injury or an insertion into the brain or a head injury can cause increases in NFL that are unrelated to Huntington's. So it's basically a general marker for kind of injury. And it's a bit confusing sometimes to interpret because there may be other reasons why NFL goes up and that. But in general, it's not a good thing. So it's obviously something I'm sure Wave are thinking about in terms of how they consider, you know, future designs. And it's something that came out of the another trial that of the same type where there was similar frequency of dosing and similar kind of increases of NFL in people with more of the drug, and we still don't know how much is because of the drug itself, and it might just mean we need to kind of keep drug amount to lower levels or things like that. It's still a lot. That's why it's important to do these trials and like I say, get to level, because we know in that previous trial there were increases in NFL that didn't show any safety issues at the time, but when you later on they had an effect on.
Well, that study you're talking about, Lauren, there were increases because I actually worked on that program as well, and obviously I can't speak for that sponsor anymore. It's in the literature published. The NFL,
in terms of ventricular volume, I think we're getting too specific now into sciences.
Settle down there, see you
soon. I think the bottom line is we keep a very close eye on something like NFL. We did see some increases at the moment. We're not actually worried about this, and we're moving to a less frequent dosing regimen every weeks. So something to keep a very close eye on, and something that we think is manageable with the future study design.
So NFL going up is bad. And as Lauren said, it can go up for other reasons, not related to HD. Yeah. But are we purposely trying to lower the
NFL? So
the
two,
NFL. Yeah, are we purposely trying to lower it?
That's a very good question. So two ways in which NFL is thought about. One is what we call a safety biomarker. And this is what we've just been discussing, that you want to make sure that this is not increasing rapidly, because that could mean that the drug, that patients are not tolerating the drug. And, you know, obviously you don't want to be causing damage through giving a drug. So that's why you keep a close eye on that. The second way is, and Lauren alluded to this, would be NFL increases with Huntington's disease. If you were lowering NFL, that could be an indicator that your drug is working. This is a very hot topic in Huntington's disease in general. NFL is one of the biomarkers that many researchers are looking at as a potential biomarker to understand whether drugs are working early. So yes, a lowering of NFL could be an indicator that a drug is working. Lauren,
and in other diseases where there are drugs that have helped benefit the patients. So for example, there's a very severe disease in children called spinal muscular atrophy, which is a very extreme example because they don't, they're so affected that they might not develop, you know, to the point where they learn to walk or things like that. And the drug that was so effective that they were meeting milestones that they wouldn't have, you see dramatic reductions in NFL. You see it in multiple sclerosis, which is another brain disease, which has lesions in the brain, where people can have relapses where they are affected and go into remission. You see lowering of NFL when they get better, and also after they get drugs that help. So we don't yet have a drug that's shown that clinical, what we call a disease modification. So being able to slow Huntington's, you know, this is very early days for the WAVE program, and I'm very excited and hopeful. But that we hope if we have a drug that works in Huntington's, NFL will also change in that sense, that will help then future programs use NFL to tell them if their drug's working. Does that make sense, Ashley?
Yeah, I think it does. So it's NFL goes up, bad. NFL goes down, good. We use NFL as a biomarker, and a biomarker is just a way to tell if something's working or not.
Yeah, and it's a more sensitive way. So a lot of the clinical, we use as clinical endpoints are things that the doctor might ask you questions about, might get you to tap your fingers together. And, you know, they're useful for their purpose, but they're not quite as sensitive.
Yeah.
And they're not as useful, you know, if we want to go earlier in treating disease, maybe prevent Huntington's from happening. So if we wanted to treat people before they have symptoms, how are we going to tell if the drug's working if we're using, you know, measures of symptoms? So yeah. That's where, yeah, Anne-Marie might have more.
No,
to
that's
add.
Yeah. See, I should be in a lab, guys. That's all I'm saying.
So with NFL, I think one of the things that's still not known, because Lauren gave some really great examples there, is for Huntington's disease and maybe also diseases that are impacted with protein aggregates in the brain. So for instance, in Alzheimer's disease, there was a drug that was recently approved where there was a big NFL increase, which then reduced over time, and those patients went on to have cognitive improvement, which was the basis of that drug being approved. So I think it would be great if NFL could be a biomarker in Huntington's disease overall, but we don't know yet enough about NFL and HD. I don't know, Lauren, would you agree with that? There's still more work.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, that's why I do a lot of my research is on NFL in people, not in trials, but trying to get as much information that we have. But I know we are got so much to talk about.
Yeah, we should move on.
There's even more new exciting news, so go ahead.
Yeah, so one thing we did see in the study, which was also very interesting, and another biomarker which is of a lot of interest in the Huntington's field at the moment, and that's about the caudate. So the caudate is a part of the brain made of specific brain cells that appear to be quite sensitive to the abnormal Huntington protein. And as the protein accumulates in this part of the brain, it's bad for these cells. It causes them to be lost over time, and that results in something called atrophy, which is basically a loss of that tissue, so it becomes smaller. And this area of the brain is like a central processing area, and it's where like movement and thought and regulation of movement is undertaken. It impacts cognition and mood and function. And so loss of the cells in this part of the brain is one of the earliest signs and earliest changes in Huntington's disease. And that occurs before patients experience symptoms. And so it's a really interesting area to be looking at in terms of, if you were giving a drug, are you, and the reduction of the bad protein, if that's having some benefit, you would hope that you would lose these cells in the caudate more slowly, or perhaps stop them being lost. So that's why it's a very interesting area of research, and it's measured by MRI. Do we need to explain what MRI is, do you think, Lauren?
So basically a big machine that has big magnets that takes pictures of your brain, and you can look at the structure in it.
That's like the tunnel that you lie in.
Yeah, it's very claustrophobic. It makes a lot of noise. So magnetic resonance imaging, MRI.
The big tunnel.
The big tunnel, yeah. So again, this study, the caudate, the looking at caudate atrophy, this study was not designed or powered to look at this change. But one of the things we saw when we analyzed the data was that we saw a statistical correlation between the removal of the mutant, the bad protein, and the slowing of the loss of the caudate, which could imply that it's a good thing to remove the protein. And I think that's the first time this has been shown in a study, but I think it has to be emphasized, another study is going to be needed to really determine whether the removal of the mutant protein is having a good impact on the brain overall, so slowing the loss of these important cells in the caudate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. It's a very important part of the brain and part of Huntington's, and it's something that is another biomarker that would be really useful very early. So if we think about kind of our younger population and going earlier and trying to see if we can prevent diseases, caudate volume, or that part of the brain, is one of the only things that are affected, you know, over 15, potentially 20 years from someone's, what we say, predicted onset based on their mutation or CAG repeat length. So that an NFL are these biomarkers that will hopefully might get us closer to being able to run these trials earlier. If that makes sense.
I've just got a wee bit lost. Is that something that, like, way back at the start of our conversation today, we said, you know, like, we have our main reason for doing this trial is the safety, but then we have like B, C, D, and E that we're also going to sneakily look at as well. Yeah. Is the caudate atrophy one of those minor points that looked at, and then hopefully, maybe all being well, you might look at that more in the future, and it's just a case of doing an MRI scan to see a very specific part of our brain, which, as you described, seems to house all of the symptoms for Huntington's, by what I heard. Like, you were rhyming, I was sitting there going,
yeah,
so we found Huntington's in the brain.
It makes sense that you know, we actually know a lot about that part of the brain and what it does because of Huntington's, fun fact, because it's very specific earlier on in that part of the brain, and it's basically just the command center for everything. So mm-hmm. a lot of the circuits in the brain and everything talks to each other, almost goes through this part of the brain.
Yeah.
So that I use doing like the MRI scans to keep an eye on the caudate section of the brain, like, now throughout the trial. You know, that's what you were doing, keep an eye on it.
We looked at the whole brain, you know, because we were looking at the ventricles and, you know, the whole brain volume and all the different structures. But the caudate is something that is very interesting because it's related, but and some other structures around there as well that are important for this disease in particular. So as you said, we looked at the safety, that was the primary. We looked at the way that the mutant or the abnormal protein was being removed and the good protein was being preserved. That was a secondary, and chordate and also some of these clinical outcomes were exploratory. And we saw this interesting observation between the secondary outcome, which is the removal of the mutant or the abnormal protein, and the slowing of the loss of cells from this specific, so the potential preservation of this part of the brain. And exactly to your point, to really understand, is that real? We have to do another study that's designed specifically to look at this part of the brain. It has the right number of patients and the right amount of follow-up so that we can statistically test whether we are meaningfully slowing the loss of these cells in the brain compared with people who are not being treated with wave 003.
So in an ideal world, like hypothetically ideal world, we're living in Ashley's brain right now, by the way. We lower the mutant protein, yeah, and all's good. And we keep an eye on the caudate section of the brain, as well as like other areas we know. And yeah, the caudate section of the brain doesn't decline as much as what it does in a non-treated patient with Huntington's disease. Like that would be like our ideal world, to lower the mutant protein, which everybody at home is the bad Huntington protein.
Yeah.
I'm learning. I'm so proud of myself. So we lower the mutant Huntington protein and the caudate section of the brain doesn't decline.
Like, yeah, that's right. You want to lower the protein. You hope then that that means that the structure of the brain is preserved or the loss is slower. So you should then want to see further down the line that this is delaying the onset of the Huntington symptoms. So in an ideal world in future, that could mean, you know, many more years of being able to live without Huntington symptoms, like slowing the onset of the Huntington symptoms. And of course, that's what people living with Huntington, but to be able to delay the disease could be a really meaningful first step for people living with Huntington's disease.
Yeah, and that's, Maria, as somebody from the HD community, like I get what you were trying to say there. It's, you know, my dad took the disease when he was in his late 30s, diagnosed at 40. If we could delay that until, you know, let's say, like, pretend like his 70s or 80s, you know, would that be a benefit? Would we have, you know, achieved a goal? So I get what you're saying. It's you know, if we can push that back a couple of years and give patients a few more years before symptoms would set in, you know, it's one way moving
That's
forward.
It's the dream, and it's the quality of life as well, you know.
Yeah,
it's longer, it's health, being healthy and enjoying life as long as possible. So I know we've been chatty Cathy's because there's so much exciting stuff. Let's kind of bring things back to, you know, what's next for the coming year.
Yeah. So we are hopeful to be able to execute another study where we would be looking at the reduction of the abnormal protein, the slowing of the loss of the chordate, and hopefully we'll start to see some better outcomes in the clinic. It won't be powered to look at the clinical outcomes, because to do that, you need a very big study. But a medium, modest size study of, you know, say 100 to 150 patients, we would be able to look at the impact of the chordate of the treatment. And the reason we want to do this is that we're in discussion with regulators about a potential regulatory pathway that could bring a drug to patients more quickly. So there are some specific ways in which regulators can take data on a biomarker like chordate or NFL, and you administer the drug and you show that you're having an impact on this biomarker. And if the regulators believe that that biomarker is like relevant to this disease, and that there's enough data to suggest that if you are changing this biomarker, you should eventually impact the clinical outcomes, they will sometimes allow drugs to be approved more quickly in those circumstances. And in the US, this is called accelerated approval. And in Europe, it's called conditional approval. So we're in the process of trying to discuss this concept with regulators, because if this pathway could be established, and I think in general, this is a really important concept for the HD community, because obviously you are all, you know, eager and quite justifiably urgently anticipating therapies to come through. So if there's a way for these studies to be done more efficiently so that you can start getting evidence that the drugs might be having some help, might be helping in some way, that's a really reasonable thing for the community to want. So those discussions are ongoing with the regulators. We're not the only company, of course, having these kinds of discussions with the regulators. But I think it's really important to emphasize that, you know, the need for finding more efficient ways to do this research is something that's really critical for the community. And I know you guys, HDYO in particular, are very important voices in that conversation with the regulators.
I know it's all amazing news, Anne-Marie. I forgot to touch on earlier when we were talking about SNPs, and so yeah. Reminder that those are the markers on the that we look for that to make it allele selective, which, as we remember, is just a copy of a gene. But the SNPs are basically the tags that they try and find that are only on the bad copy and not on the good copy. So it means that not everybody has these SNPs or tags on their DNA. So could you talk a bit, Anne-Marie, about how common it is for people to have these SNPs and what that might mean in terms of how many people this drug would be applicable
to help? Yeah, it's a really great question. So the literature estimates the prevalence of this SNP, so how often you see this SNP, is about 40% of the HD population. And I think there are other SNPs that could be unique, that could help us identify the rest of the population who couldn't be eligible at present if they didn't have SNP 3. So, you know, with the continuation of the program, we would be looking to develop other drugs that would target other SNPs to expand the population to as many people as we can with HD to try and slow their disease. So it's a great question, Lauren.
And I guess if there's success with this one, it would make that process a lot easier,
right,
for any new targets coming out or any new drugs.
I was just going to say that. I was like, I think when a lot of people, because I know whenever I first started chatting with you guys and trying to understand the SNPs and, you know, your drug trial, it took a hot minute for my brain to process it. But my first thought was, oh gosh, you know, if I test positive for Huntington's, what if I don't have, what if this works? And what if I don't have the SNP? And right. Then like, I can't, you know, get the, you know, the potential treatment that, you know, you're working on. And I think it's still good news though, because if you get this SNP and you get it to work with this batch, then you'll move on to the next and you'll move on to the next. And I think that's definitely a big reminder for the community that every step that we take is a step in the right direction, whether it's good news or bad news, because even the bad news allows us to figure out what went wrong and what we can do again. And like that, if you figure this SNP out, because there's a lot of SNPs, I learned that before. If you figure this SNP out, then you can go to the next SNP and the next SNP. And that's then hopefully going to cover more of the population. So that's my little 10 cents from a community member. Just let my fellow community members not to get, you know, too bogged down on, it's only a small part of the community. But at the same time, making sure that they're very much aware of that and that, you know, it's not maybe going to work for everybody.
Yeah, that's such a great point. And I wanted to also just say, you know, all this stuff we've been having about the caudate, those observations have been entirely driven by the HD community, people participating in, you know, enroll and other like track HD, predict HD. people very generously donating their data to allow researchers to find these new insights that are driving new approaches to the drug development. And so, I mean, it's really driven by you guys, but we're very grateful for all the contributions in SELECT-HD and outside of SELECT-HD. And you really do have the power and you are making a difference.
Mm-hmm. And as someone who's on both sides of the fence, I personally get that response from a lot of people that come into the HD field about, you know, we're so well set up because we've such an engaged community, we've got such resources of what we call this natural history data, these biomarkers, and we're better off than other similar diseases, I think, particularly for one that's as relatively rare. I think if we can get one drug approved, it will, I think, accelerate things for the whole community. Not just for this program, but for other programs. So it's all positive.
You see that actually in, you know, neurodegeneration as a whole, as soon as one drug gets approved, it drives so much more like investment and more ideas and more people build on those ideas. So that's definitely the way that we'll get more for this community.
Can I ask a question? My brain's been working. Say the caudate section of our brain and the way you were saying about doing the MRIs to keep an eye on it to watch that it doesn't go downhill too much. It would be better, like, the earlier you can start doing the MRIs on people's brains, the better, because then, so like, I'll use, you know, maybe, so if you had somebody very, very, like, you know, let's say to look at them, you'd be like, no symptoms, you know, but you would have an MRI of their brain, and then you would maybe like watch them over the course of however many years, and then you'd be fit to like watch their brain in that section.
But so I think the this observation that the caudate is changing many years before the diagnosis basically implies that we should be intervening a lot earlier in the disease before the symptoms have become evident, because you want to save as much as you can, you know, as early as you can. Mm-hmm. So I think it will potentially drive studies to be in earlier populations, younger populations, which are very relevant to HDYO as well. You asked exactly the right question there, Ashley. I think that's exactly right. So the MRI is just how we measure it, but the fact that we can see something happening implies there's an opportunity, the potential opportunity to intervene a bit earlier in these studies.
Thank you, Amri. That's what I was sort of trying to get at, but it wasn't coming out very well, because I was thinking that, and I was like, does this mean that we should be doing this earlier and getting involved sooner and younger and earlier in our symptoms and not waiting until it's like fully noticeable? Like, you know, I'm picturing my dad as I speak, so I am, and I'm, you know, I remember the years where he definitely had HD, but we didn't visually notice anything. And then I'm picturing the years where it was like, he's sort of doing things that granny used to do, because it was visually noticeable to us. And that's what was like running about in my head there. But no, you managed to bring it back and explain it perfectly. So I love that, you know, potentially the younger we get people, you know, it could have a very good benefit then on, you know, the community and that younger generation, because if it worked, then it would keep that quality of life as is, and it wouldn't be pausing somebody in a stage of the symptoms.
But fully appreciate that will be a big decision for anyone who wants to get involved.
100%.
You know, you also want to live your life and enjoy your life.
100%.
And that's kind of, I think, a good place to leave it. It's definitely where the field is moving, and it's a big push in the scientific community to really reach out and engage. And it's why, you know, at HDYO, we're really passionate about having these two-way conversations with as many, you know, key players. One thing I just wanted to clarify as well with the MRI and the images. So a lot of the tools we use in trials are very much research tools and not what we'd say clinically ready, or something that you would do with your doctor. So people would only have these MRI scans, and they're very specialist MRI scans that have very specialist people that draw the images around, because it's quite a specific marker. So it's not something yet. Maybe in the future, you know, in years from now, it might get kind of introduced into regular clinical care, but it's a bit harder with things like MRI that need very specialist people to do them, to get that kind of into standards of care. And it's something that comes up, I think, for us with the, and I don't want to get into a whole other conversation, because we've got so much to chat about today, but I think we have to like close things off. But people know about the Huntington's disease integrated staging system, which has been developed in the last couple of years, which has introduced this measure, this caudate volume and putamen, so these are that part of the brain that's affected, as kind of the threshold for the first stage of this new way of thinking about Huntington's disease as being your stage zero, when you carry the gene and have no signs or symptoms or any markers, biological markers, and creating this stage one, which is much earlier than has been looked at in trials, is allowing this framework for companies like Wave to eventually do these studies. But it's all very much research tools at this point. So just to reiterate to the community that it's not something that is going to be beneficial for you understanding your disease just yet. And I think we'll get there in some years time, but just for the current, just to kind of set expectations for the community. So just to finish off, where can the community learn more and keep updated on what's happening?
So we are busily writing up our results from this study, and they will get posted in things like clinicaltrials.gov and UGCT, which are two databases that exist to update patients on research that's ongoing, how it's designed, and then what the results of those things are. And I'm sure we will be publishing the data at some point as well. And we anticipate coming back with an update on how our discussions on the regulatory pathway have gone with the regulators, and we're hopeful to be able to run another study that could further look at wave 003 and its impact on caudate atrophy. So
and of course we will continue to keep everyone updated at HDYO with our regular video updates and snippets on Instagram and our website, which you can find more. And of course, I almost forgot that the Wave team will also be attending the Congress next year.
That's right.
So if people are attending, they may get to see people like Anne-Marie and chat to the people kind of making it happen.
Look forward to it. Thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.